The most dangerous gangs in America have transformed Pelican Bay State Prison into a battlefield.
It's a war zone. Literally a war zone.
Violence is their way of life.
Whenever a stabbing had to go down, I'm the one who called it.
Violence that extends beyond these walls.
Many of the stabbings, even killings on the streets, are called right from here, from Pelican Bay.
Gang leaders here control organized crime on the street from inside their cells. But the prison's fighting back.
Get out! Get out!
At Pelican Bay, there's a war on the way. A war to stop the gangs by targeting their leaders. But is it a war they can win? Twice a week, buses arrive at Pelican Bay State Prison with another load of gang members.
Go ahead, step on down. Step over there, face the officer.
Bill, H39468.
What do you run?
Bloods.
Every prison in California has gang members. But the most violent and hard to handle are sent here.
Okay, turn your head to the right and just your head.
Pelican Bay was built to control these felons by housing them together in one facility. But instead of stopping them, prison has become a kind of corporate headquarters for their vast criminal enterprise. For many, admission isn't a punishment, it's a privilege they've worked hard for.
What do you run with?
Everybody that's anybody strives to make it to Pelican Bay for that notoriety. This is where all the killers come. If you made it to Pelican Bay, you've made it.
Once here, gang members climb the ranks through acts of loyalty and violence, constantly improving their skills.
Pelican Bay is sort of like a big university for criminals. They don't come here to rehabilitate themselves. They come here to hone their criminal skills. And the criminals that come in, when they leave, most of them are a lot better skilled when they leave than when they came in.
Gang leaders have turned this prison into a command center. From behind bars, they run illegal drug trade in California, control thousands of street gang members, and even order killings. In April 1999, Nuestra Familia gang leaders executed a hit on a former gang member in San Jose, 400 miles away. After the killing, they decided the hired gun had done a sloppy job, so they had him murdered as well. And they did it all from inside Pelican Bay. The prison is 350 miles from San Francisco. Built in 1989, it was carved out of redwood forests in the wilds of Northern California on purpose. Prison officials wanted to isolate gang members from the outside world. And within the prison, a fortress-like design further segregates inmates from one another. The prison is split into two facilities, the security housing unit, where they isolate the gang leaders, and the main line, home of the foot soldiers. The main line holds 2,000 prisoners in two main buildings. The buildings are divided into cell blocks, each home to 120 men. The yard is the only place where all the prisoners congregate. Armed sharpshooters monitor every movement from the towers above. In 17 years, no one has ever escaped. 9 a.m. Yard B is open. The prisoners here are made up of four ethnic gangs. They call themselves the Blacks, the Whites, the Northern Mexicans, and the Southern Mexicans. Sergeant Navarro knows each of these gangs intimately. He's studied their every move for 10 years.
right here, you have the Northern Mexicans. The Northern Mexicans always hang out in groups of two. They do that for their own security measures. Right now they have two on their workout station and two on their bench. For the blacks, you have the Crips, you have the Bloods, you have the 415s, which are, again, they're the Bay Area guys here out of San Francisco. They're hanging out right here in front of us. They're working out. Now, the Southern Mexicans, they really just kind of, they hang out in their own area over here, like all the groups do, but all the groups out here. And I would say the Southern Mexicans are probably the most dangerous and well-prepared to carry out assaults, homicides, mass violence. They are always ready in the event that something's going to occur. You have the white boys. Most of them will probably lean towards the Nazi Little Riders or the NLR or the Aryan Brotherhood, the AB.
One of those white boys is Joseph Shotgun Harmon.
I have bolts under my armpit, regained by stabbing an African.
Harmon is doing 17 years for assault with a deadly weapon.
Years of stabbing, violence predicted. Biker having his throat cut by me.
He's also a member of the Nazi Lowriders, a gang leader who agreed to take us inside one of the most murderous organizations in the United States.
But we're about killing. I'm getting next to you and killing you. You know, get you in the house and kill you. Two people move in that house, then one goes out in a body bag.
Violence is how Harmon made his bones and got into the Nazi Lowriders. It's how everyone gets in.
I'm a blooded Nazi Lowrider. That means for each letter I have, I stab somebody to get my letters.
Harmon earned his way to Pelican Bay in 2002 by stabbing an inmate in another prison. Within a few years, he became a shot caller, the man in charge in the prison yard.
When there's something going on, you hold court, you go commandeer a corner of the yard and sit down with three or four of the power on the yard and you'll talk to them. Every single day, it's drama, drama, drama. And not drama on a soap opera, it's life and death drama. Every single day you step out that door, you don't know if you're walking back through it.
Sergeant Navarro and all the guards feel the danger every time they step into Yard B.
You always have to be prepared for the event that these guys are going to attack us.
It's no exaggeration. This morning, there are 180 prisoners out here and just six guards.
I mean, it doesn't really matter what kind of numbers you have. If they decided right now at this point for 10 of them to come over and attack us, you're going to lose. I mean, there's no way that you're going to try to win in those kind of numbers. We're on the losing end of that battle.
A battle that never seems to end. In 2004 alone, there were 359 violent attacks at Pelican Bay. Assaults, stabbings, and slashings. But the prison is striking back. There are 960 prison officers to control the inmates on the main line. But Pelican Bay has also formed an elite team to target their leaders. Clint McMillan was trained as a Navy SEAL. He's part of the Internal Gang Investigations Unit, a team of 16 specialists leading the prison's counter-assault. Their strategy to stop the gangs: bust open the leader's communication network and get important members to leave the gang. In the process, some choose to become informants, helping McMillan's unit to stop further violence.
We're basically taking the head off the snake, that's what we want to do.
And this is one of the men they're targeting, a key member of one of Pelican Bay's most powerful gangs. His true identity can't be revealed. If his gang discovers he's under investigation, they'll murder him. This gangster is a vicious killer. Several years ago, he orchestrated a brutal murder. Now, he's doing life without parole. If the unit can turn him into an informer, it will be a major breakthrough in their war to infiltrate and stop his gang. But getting this hardened criminal to leave the gang is going to be a difficult battle. Pelican Bay State Prison's most powerful weapon in their war against the gangs is the Security Housing Unit, the SHU. The prison removes top leaders from their gangs and segregates them here. Inmates call this the tomb. This morning, the guards are prepping a cell for a gang leader.
We're checking for any kind of false compartment. We're checking for any kind of contraband left here from the previous inmate. All the inmates, 99% of the inmates, are housed in here 22 and a half hours a day. They get an hour and a half for showers and exercise, and they're generally single-celled.
Just 11 feet long and 6 feet wide, the cell has one purpose: breaking prisoners through complete isolation and deprivation.
Hell on earth, you never know whether you're gonna make it or not to the next day.
It's a lonely existence being in the shoe. Here, Pelican Bay, that is.
If you haven't heard, the history of this prison is the worst history of a prison in the United States, is this prison right here.
The shoe can hold up to 1,100 inmates. It's divided into 22 units, called pods. Each pod has 6 corridors. Each corridor has 8 cells. The pod is controlled from here, the nerve center. No one moves without the okay from Officer Pitts Campbell. From this perch, he can watch every one of the 76 doors in his unit. Prisoners can't see beyond their bars, and they can't move unless Pitts Campbell says so. He never opens more than one door at a time. Make a mistake, people die.
We're dealing with the most violent and assaultive inmates in the state of California. The entire design of this is to limit their access to other inmates and to staff, so they have no opportunity to assault anybody else.
But they still do. These gang leaders will seize any opportunity for violence. They're so ruthless and relentless, they've even transformed the SHU, one of the most secure places in the prison, into one of the most dangerous. Many would attack the guards if they could get close enough. And 2 times a day, they do. It's 5 p.m., dinner time. This is a dangerous moment, one of the few times during the day when the guards are vulnerable. Inmates have used weapons to attack officers through the open food ports and the holes in their cell doors.
Okay, so it's close attention at this point. This is probably the most dangerous time for the officers because they have the food ports open and the inmate is, of course, unrestrained inside the cell, which gives them free access to any weapons they may have created.
This inmate shows how he makes a lethal spear from tightly wound paper and uses elastic from his clothing to launch it.
I speared him, stabbed him, hit him, spit on him, climbed up on the control booth bars with throwed it all in there, and the police shot me with the fire extinguisher, and I'd do it again.
Some inmates in here will save up their urine and feces, and they don't necessarily have to dislike a particular officer. It can be just any officer. And they get an opportunity. They come to their cell, and they'll throw it right in their face. We've had so many officers gassed in that manner. It's disgusting.
But attacking officers isn't the only way prisoners have undermined the SHU's purpose. Leaders of the prison's 4 main gangs, who call themselves the Southern Mexicans, the Northern Mexicans, the Blacks, and the Whites, have figured out how to run their organizations from inside this concrete bunker. Despite being locked down 22 and a half hours a day.
I was back there in the SHU for 9 years.
Epitacio Cortino was a top lieutenant with Nuestra Familia, part of the Northern Mexican gang. He ran his business from inside his SHU cell.
And even though I was isolated, stuck with myself for 22 and a half hours a day, without any type of window to society or what have you, I still had the means and the creativity to conduct illegal crime out there in society.
From the SHU, Cortina controlled gang operations 400 miles away. He was in charge of a Nuestra Familia regiment that spanned an entire city.
Basically, my responsibility at that time was to oversee the activities of San Jose in California, whether it be murder, bank robbery, armored car robbery, drug dealing, money laundering, you name it.
Cortina also controlled illegal crime inside Pelican Bay. The inmates who did his bidding were here on the mainline.
We have the foot soldiers out here of the larger gangs. Most of the gang leaders are all locked up in the security housing unit. These guys out here are the ones that do the business, that sell the drugs, collect the drugs, do the assaults, do the murders, and carry on their little war that they have going on.
The key to Cortina's success was communication. This is phishing. With a little thread from their shorts, gang leaders can pass an order from one end of the SHU to the other. The commanders send their directives out using an old-fashioned method, letters.
Doesn't matter where the cell's at. If we can fish it, we'll get it there.
And letters can be lethal. In 2001, an FBI sting dubbed Operation Black Widow connected 15 murders on the outside to gang leaders in Pelican Bay. This surveillance video captures Nuestra Familia gang members discussing their written orders sent from leaders like Epitacio Cortina.
This is coming from the high command. I'm conveying to you what the high command wants us to do.
Many of the stabbings, even killings on the streets down in Los Angeles, are called right from here, from Pelican Bay.
Gang investigator Clint McMillan suspects that his target, a key gang member, is also using the mail to send gang orders to associates on the outside.
This guy right here, do you remember seeing that guy, his name? I don't think he's one of our big ones.
Officers Dejeuner and Drown have been assigned to comb through the gang members' correspondence.
Well, I know it says Adriana, but he's Adrian.
They're also searching for drugs. Every day, 5,000 pieces of mail wash through Pelican Bay, some carrying contraband.
This particular card, it's an Easter card, right? But what this is, this whole card right here is soaked in methamphetamine. And when you turn it over, you can see a little bit better. You see part of it that's stained. Today, they're getting so good at this that you won't even see the stain.
They'll take a black
heroin is smuggled into the prison in the most ingenious ways.
This postcard, they'll buy two identical postcards just like this. On one of the postcards, they will carefully access and half the postcard and tear the back of that first postcard off. Okay. Then they'll take and they'll take heroin and they'll put that in cellophane, wrap that in cloth, and then they can iron that heroin to paper thin. Then they'll put the heroin on top of the second postcard, then put the top of the first postcard back on top of it. So you'll have a postcard that'll look just like this, almost paper thin and almost undetectable. And this one appears to be clear. If there were heroin in the dark spots of this postcard, my light would not penetrate. And then I would know that we need to carefully access this postcard and get the drugs out. This postcard's clear. So we just continue on.
Today, they don't find any drugs, but they do intercept a coded letter.
There's a regular message there. Doesn't look anything out of the ordinary. The officer down here in the mailroom, he, by further inspecting the inside of the card, what he did, he cut this open, and right here is what they call ghostwriting. And I think you can see it there. The message here was going to a gang member in a security housing unit, and they're asking permission to stab an inmate on our general population.
But all of their targets' correspondence is written in code. If McMillan can decode the letters, he'll have evidence against the gang member and could pressure him to leave the gang and become an informant.
That's something here of interest to you.
He is a major key in their gang communication, so taking him out, it really shuts their communication down.
Getting him to flip would cripple his gang. But it's extremely hard to convince key gang members to give up their power. They don't trust officers' promises of a better life. The world of prison gangs is brutal, but it's what these men know.
This is my comfort zone. This is where I feel most comfortable. Not out there, not in your front yard, not in your house in the middle of the night while I'm stealing everything you got and got you tied up, torturing you or whatever. I feel comfortable right here on this yard with wars jumping off, stabbings all around me. That's where I feel comfortable. That's where my mind is the most clear and focused.
Joseph Shotgun Harmon spent 6 years in the SHU as a leader of the Nazi lowriders. Then, the Gang Investigations Unit, or IGI, confronted him with evidence of his gang-related crimes.
When the IGI told me, look, I'm going to give you this one opportunity to change your life. And I'm sitting in my cell and I'm thinking, is this what the rest of my life is going to be? Is it going to end up in this box? Is this where I'm going to die?
The IGI gave him a choice. Leave the gang or lose all visiting privileges with his family and new fiance.
To break somebody, they have to get to know that individual intimately and find out what his weakness is. With me, they found my weakness was my family and my girl. They found out what my weakness was, and that's what they used against me.
Harmon chose to leave the gang. Now, he's a marked man.
I left, but they'll kill me if they get in next to me. But all of them will, blood in, blood out. You leave in a body bag.
Harmon's new home is the transitional housing unit, a safe haven inside Pelican Bay. More than 100 former gangsters live in the unit. McMillan plans to use the same strategy against his target that was successful with Harmon. But convincing this loyal gang member to leave his gang will prove a much bigger challenge. Pelican Bay State Prison fights to stop gang activity on many fronts. One of the most dangerous battlefields is this piece of land, the yard. The four rival gangs all crowd together here for rec. If a gang member has plans for violence, this is probably where it'll go down. It's 11 a.m. Each gang is in its own established territory. The Northern Mexicans are working out. The blacks are by the picnic tables, gambling. Over on the handball court, the Southern Mexicans are playing a game. As long as the gang stays separate, there's peace.
Clear the walkway. Escort from Central Control back to PSU. Clear the walkway.
It's time to move the prisoners back into their cells. For a few moments, all of the rivals cluster by the yard's exit, within striking distance of each other. This is where outbreaks, large and small, occur. Gang members have even used the crowd as cover to turn against their own.
A lot of times they'll commit assaults during this time because there's just everyone is grouped together in one lump. So we're going to move out of this area as quickly as we can, and we'll assist in the yard recall and push these guys up to the buildings to get them where they're supposed to be. This is when a lot of stuff happens. It's very difficult to try to see in the middle of these groups, and anything can happen at any given time.
They're just about to move the prisoners back into the building when, in the blink of an eye, the yard erupts.
Get out.
Center Control, Bravo Yard Sergeant Navarro. We are code one, fist fight, blacks. Check him real quick.
Two black inmates attack one another. The fight is probably overpowering status. Although it looks spontaneous, it wasn't. Permission for fights must be granted by leaders in the security housing unit. No gang member acts on his own. And he would be severely punished if he did.
Unfortunately, we had to use spandrel and batons to get him to stop fighting. And they're seeking medical attention at this point. And recalling our yard, and hopefully we're not going to have another problem.
The inmates are cuffed and moved inside. Then, a weapon is discovered.
Officer Ward's recovered the weapon from this spot. We did place it, or had him place it back in the spot just to show at the time of when he discovered it where it was. So that's where it was. It's not much of a weapon, but it still is considered a weapon.
This knife could have caused serious injury, but it's nothing compared to some of the weapons the prison has confiscated. Inmates manufacture weapons out of anything they can get their hands on. The prison saves a variety of homemade knives, called shanks, as a teaching tool for new officers.
So this is our display. This is a perfect display of the types of weapons that we find here at Pelican Bay. You've got all.
While all weapons are a threat, it's the ones carved out of metal that scare officers.
Metal tip. You can see by the thickness of this gauge of metal, very thick, very sturdy, extremely dangerous. These are the ones that we love very much to find, because once we find them, we know that they're not going to be used on us as officers, and they're not going to be used on inmates.
But to use the weapons, inmates have to have them nearby. Many prisoners risk serious injury to conceal their knives inside their bodies.
Well, this is an example. This is an x-ray of how an inmate was able to hide the weapon in his anal cavity and actually get it out to the yard. Now what you see there is one half of a pair of scissors. What you don't see is the paper and the cellophane that is wrapped around it so that it enables him to hide it in his anal cavity.
The flow of arms is never ending. Guards shake prisoners down each time they go out to the yard. Still, the weapons get through.
Probably got people out there right now that got weapons inside their rectum or cheek, when I mean cheek, just between their butt cheeks, walking around, so that way if something happens, they can easily take out that weapon and go ahead and handle their business. It's mandatory each group have their own stock weapon out there, just in case you got to go to war.
In the security housing unit, guards regularly search the inmate cells for weapons. At 5 p.m., the squad prepares for a surprise raid.
Make sure that you check under their arms and their waistbands real well, because that's where they're beating us on the weapons when they come out.
For months, the Gang Investigations Unit has been gathering evidence against a key member of one of the prison's most dangerous gangs. Tonight, Clint McMillan and his squad will search a block of cells looking for evidence to connect their target with gang crimes. This is a dangerous operation. One of the inmates in this block has threatened to kill officers.
He wants to kill staff, so make sure that we treat him very carefully, all right? We are told that he always has a weapon. He always is able to hide it pretty well.
Shorts and shower shoes, guys. Step down.
Shorts and shirt and shower shoes.
The squad approaches the inmate in force. They maneuver him out of his cell. Officers spot a knife hidden in his armpit.
This is a weapon that was discovered in the armpit of the gentleman occupying his cell. We believe he's probably sharpening this piece of metal that's wrapped in his handle. It's about 3 1/4 inches long, 3/4 inch wide at the widest point. It's a more of a slashing weapon to stab you with this. It's not going to go too terribly deep, but to slash you, if you get caught on the throat or something like this, it would be very, very bad.
The gang member goes into holding with other inmates from the block. Officers ripped their cells apart.
And more metal, more magnets. Also, we have a razor blade here.
In a cell on the bottom tier, they uncover deadly contraband, a razor blade. Then, they hit pay dirt. It's a letter written in the gang's code. This piece of paper could provide evidence against their target.
What they're saying here is
the inmate has translated several words.
Yeah, this is definitely a code. They're saying the word for billing is block, B-L-O-K. And then another word, I don't know if that's men of some kind. And here's a bunch of numbers with the code word beside it.
Yeah, don't move that. That's good stuff.
We just come back from the raid. We have found some of the codes. We have found also, we found some symbols and stuff like that, artwork and so forth, that who talks with who. We're seeing the circle of code words, again, focusing on one individual and small groups of individuals. We don't have the whole story completely yet. We're going to break down the code and work on it a little bit more.
But as McMillan quickly discovers, that's not so easy to do. The code is highly sophisticated. Knowing a few translated words is not enough to decode entire letters.
They'll encode a letter, and it'll start like with, it just goes to gibberish. It says, you can't get my drowning Zen champion. You thought Jeff Xerox stood acclaimed, excluding Viking modus and warrior long boots rendered favorable.
He can't break the code on his own. McMillan turns to the experts, the FBI's cryptology unit. If the FBI can help him decode the letters, they could provide the evidence he needs to get this key member to turn against his gang. It's 7 in the morning, and Pelican Bay State Prison is in crisis. A routine check of prison inventory has revealed that the blade from a barber's razor is missing.
Everybody remember, this is what we're looking for. It's the top of the hair clipper razor.
The blade is stainless steel. Inmates could use it to cut the metal furniture in their cells and build an arsenal of weapons. Even now, they could be mass-producing knives.
Top tier.
The staff begin an exhaustive search for the missing clippers. The entire population of the mainline is put on lockdown. Prisoners won't leave their cells except for showers and emergencies. The officers have to find the clippers before the inmates arm themselves for a riot. It's happened before. February 23rd, 2000, 9:38 a.m. Yard B explodes. 300 Southern Mexican gang members attack the blacks. At least 100 are armed with homemade weapons. Gunners in the buildings surrounding the yard open up with tear gas and rubber bullets. But nothing stops the rampage, so they begin firing live rounds. There's a full-scale war underway.
There were gunshots coming out of the gunfire coming out of the buildings. They were shooting from the gun tower. It was more chaotic than any riot I've ever seen. There were inmates running in every different direction. Some were running away from the attackers. Some were facing attackers and trying to fight them.
The riot burns out of control before the death of a prisoner shuts it down.
Right here, you see a group of black inmates. They're stabbing this guy right down here. And the gunner, he took the shot. And when he took the shot, there he is. There's the inmate right there. They shot him right in the head. If he hadn't shot that particular inmate, the victim that he was stabbing probably would have died right there.
After the most intense 30 minutes in prison history, one inmate is dead. 15 have been shot. And an astounding 89 weapons are recovered. Now, 5 years after the riot, Pelican Bay once again faces a deadly threat. Officers are keenly aware that the missing clippers could create enough weapons to fuel another war.
These are steel beds, and they'll use this lip here. Sometimes they'll actually cut the metal stock right out, and they'll take soap, and they'll fill this in with soap, and they'll use paint, and they'll repaint it. And unless you really poke at these areas here, you won't even know it's missing.
Officers will search every one of the mainline's 832 cells. It's the only way to make sure that inmates and staff are safe.
You don't know what they're planning. Maybe they're looking for metal stock to create weapons for an assault that's upcoming on other inmates. Maybe they're looking at attacking staff.
Gang members are master craftsmen when it comes to making knives. Even everyday items can be turned to a lethal purpose.
This is a plastic bag, right? Looks real innocent. They can take this, and it takes approximately 1 hour. You melt this down, and they'll have a weapon that is approximately 5.5 inches long. They hone it down on the concrete, and they can put it inside their rectum, and they'll go out to yard with them. They make these all day long.
Here's something that looks pretty innocent. It's just a washcloth, and it could be anything, but you notice it's wrapped with this string. It doesn't take much to add some friction to the toothbrush. And just a short period of time, turn it right into a weapon.
Half an hour into this cell search, Officer Drown spots something shiny. It's a razor blade.
Wait, I'm gonna see if I can just go ahead and fish that out now. It looks like it's gonna cooperate, come right out. Being real careful not to cut myself, and there it is. So, real threat right here. This razor blade right here can easily cut an aorta, and it can cause a lot of damage very quickly.
So no clippers, but you got this.
No clippers yet, but that's a really good find. We're very happy when we find these and get them off the line.
In the security housing unit, investigator Clint McMillan tries a new tactic in his quest to take down his targeted gang member. He's going to listen in on the inmates' conversations to see if he reveals criminal plans. But the conversations don't take place on the phone. The gangster does his business out in the yard. Shoot inmates exercise alone to stop them from communicating with one another. But they've found an ingenious way to stay in touch. The Shoot recreation yards are all connected by drain pipes. A gang member can talk into the drain and pass a message to his neighbor. Using the pipes, McMillan's target can pass an order from one end of the shoe to the other, all without seeing another person. Since the yards are only monitored by camera and not microphones, the guards can't stop or even hear the conversations. But McMillan uses his Navy SEAL training and special audio equipment to eavesdrop. He moves into position. It's a delicate operation. The yards are concrete and will amplify sound, so he has to be absolutely silent. The inmate moves to the drain pipe. McMillan starts recording. Gang member has passed an order. The investigator needs more information to confront him. For today, though, this is all that he'll get. There's news waiting for McMillan back at the office. After weeks of work, the FBI's cryptology department at Quantico has cracked the code. They've discovered that the gang member is using a variation of the infamous Enigma code from World War II.
Quantico has said that it's the most sophisticated and the most secure method of encoding that they've seen in the nation.
The FBI has supplied McMillan with a series of decoded letters to and from his target. One is especially chilling. It orders gang members to kill cops. And in prison, and cops means guards.
It says to clarify the SAC Union headquarters priority, inmates, which is Woods, wanting to head out, and they should target cops in here and on the streets and be smooth so it's not linked.
But the letter isn't specific enough for McMillan to charge the inmate with a crime or to stop it from happening. All he can do is confront him.
My next step is what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this information, this evidence, basically, pull this guy out and interview him and tell him and let him know that we have broken his whole infrastructure. We have basically, we have uncovered what he's doing.
If the gang member realizes the code is broken and thinks the prison has a strong case against him, he may be willing to leave his gang and possibly become an informant. Pelican Bay offers powerful incentives to leave the gang. Ex-gang members called dropouts live in comfortable housing and have more programs, activities, and visiting privileges than inmates in the SHU. McMillan doesn't think his target will take his word for it. So he asks three dropouts to make a video telling the inmate what life is like for those willing to leave the gang. The identities of the men are hidden to protect them and their families.
You're free and clear to basically say whatever you want to say. And if there's anything that a lull spot or anything like that, just let me know and I can maybe prompt you guys to something else. Okay? Okay? All right, if you guys go ahead.
You don't have to get stuck in that tumult. You don't have to get stuck in that cycle.
Now, there's no life back there. It's just a mere existence. My only regret is that I didn't do it sooner. 15 years is a long time that I spent back there. And it's just going to get worse in the future as well.
Got store in the house, bags of store. We eat anytime we don't. We don't starve no more back there. We eat ice cream, soda pops, whatever you want. You do your little program, you get your out here, and you go wherever you need to go. This is where you can be your own man.
Armed with their words, McMillan's ready to confront the gangster. After months of investigation, tomorrow he'll make his play. Tomorrow, he'll try to convince his target to turn on his gang. It's 11 a.m., and Clint McMillan has entered the security housing unit. In a few minutes, he'll meet his target, a key member of one of Pelican Bay's four major gangs.
Hey, guys, we're just going to go in there, go right straight to the pod, and then let's try to pull him out, try to convince him to pull him out.
He hopes to convince the inmate to leave his gang.
Four.
Come on down, IGI McMillan. Come talk to me for a second.
The first step is persuading the gangster to leave his cell. Just talking to the investigations unit could get him killed for snitching.
Basically what it is, I want to be able to give you an opportunity to talk to you, okay? What we got going is we got a lot of stuff here involving you. I want to talk to you concerning your gang activity and stuff like that. Are you willing to come out so we can get this lined out and get this straightened out? I'm willing to put it all on the table.
Sure, I don't have no problem with that.
Okay.
McMillan's over the first hurdle. His plan is to reveal the broken codes and make the inmate think the prison can shut him down.
This code here, it talks about targeting police officers.
You ain't never found nothing I've ever wrote anything like that.
This is to you.
What's written to me is different than what I've written.
As they say, you did the message, and they're just relaying it for you.
That's bull****.
Okay, that's fine. Well, whoever is, okay, is saying that they're wanting to head out and they should target cops in here and on the street.
That's bull****.
That's what the code said.
I'm going to tell you right now, that's straight bull****. Whoever's saying that, You know what I mean? Shouldn't be saying that, period. Okay. I don't know what, excuse my language, why they put my name in there.
Yeah. Nope.
But they shouldn't be saying that. That's not what's happening.
Getting nowhere, McMillan switches tactics. He pulls out the video from the gang dropouts, hoping it will strike a nerve.
There's, okay, there's something else I want to show you, okay? You willing to watch it?
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
I got a future, homeboy. And out that damn box we sat in back there. You come out here, you got a future. It only ends one way, homeboy. One way. You either come over here or you die over there. There's no other way out. It's all about family, and that over there isn't your family. You know it in your heart, that's not your family. Those people are dog eat dog. You know what I'm saying? The hardest thing I ever done in my life was walk away, but it was the smartest thing I ever done. And you go wherever you
The gangster go, listens in stony silence. And then...
I don't want to hear that.
This could make a difference. These guys are not doing anything.
Take it out. I don't want to hear that no more. Take it out, man. I thought you pulled me out of here. You were going to be straight with me.
I am straight with you.
McMillan may not have got what he wanted, but he's planted the seed.
Sometimes it takes a little while for it to really sink in. That was an interesting to see, because you seen that there was a little bit of emotions involved in there. Whether he'll make the final call, we don't know.
You're in 5 minutes. You're in 5 minutes.
Out on the main line, the missing Clipperhead has been found. After 4 long weeks of cell searches, officers found the blade hidden in an undisclosed location. Lockdown is finally over. The prisoner who possessed the razor is now in isolation, pending charges. Yet despite the fine, Pelican Bay is still on edge. The state's meanest prison gangs make their home here, and they're not going to stop the violence just because the Clipper's been found.
There will be more lockdowns, and just because of the type of inmate that we house here, they are of the mentality, they are a violence-based type of inmate, and they're always trying to look for ways to either push their drugs or to get more power on the yard, to get more territory on the yard. So in my opinion, it's inevitable there will be future lockdowns.
Here, pick your poison. See, and he takes the white.
Why? Won't have his die hard.
For Shotgun Harmon and Epitacio Cortina, that cycle of violence no longer completely rules their lives.
Come on now.
Now that they're both out of the gang, they have a new perspective on their former lifestyle.
I came to see that a lot of stuff that was going on back there, you know, was a lot of cannibalistic tactics. You know, you had leaders that you looked up to, you know, preying upon other leaders, wanting to kill off one another for, you know, beneficial reasons, personal reasons.
All I have to do now is satisfy myself. And as long as I don't get violent, I'm satisfying my needs. That's what I have to do right now. No violence. I can do whatever else I got to do, no violence. Because if I don't get violent, I go home. And that's my goal, is to go home.
But they can't escape the gangs entirely. Both Harmon and Cortina are marked men. If they leave this safe haven, their gangs will try to kill them.
Me leaving the gang has put my life in jeopardy, but as well as put my family's life in jeopardy, you know, and anybody that's associated with me, their life's in jeopardy.
Clint McMillan counts Cortina and Harmon as major wins, but his target refuses to budge.
I make a difference every now and then, and but being the small group that we have, it would take some serious staffing to be able to make a difference and make an impact.
Good, step off the bus.
And for every member who leaves the gang, another is ready to take his place. Twice a week, the buses continue to arrive at Pelican Bay with a new load of hardened gang members.
You're always going to have gangs. Gangs are like cockroaches. They're going to be around to the end of the world.
The cycle of violence rolls on. A vicious series of running battles that defines life inside this prison. war between four rival gangs and the elite unit set up to stop them. A war between 960 prison officers and the 3,000 violent inmates they guard. A war to take charge of California's Pelican Bay.